Greetings, my friends. How are you doing? This is Zed from Zedoutdoors. I hope you're having an awesome day. So, this is the return of Martin Hazell. Martin, how are you doing?
I'm doing not too bad, actually, Zed. Yeah.
Yeah, it's a beautiful day in Dorset. So I'm in the southwest of England to see Martin Hazell, his brother, and his delightful partner. And I'm here. How long has it been since the last time I've come? Has it been about 5 months?
5 months, yeah.
5 months, yeah. It was a fantastic visit last time. This time round, the sun gods are shining upon us.
Indeed.
It's looking to be a beautiful few days.
Shining upon the righteous.
That's it.
And us.
That's it. And us as well, at times. And so, we are back again. See, Martin thought he'd escape doing another tutorial. But you know what? His videos were so well received last time. If you haven't seen them already, I'll put a link below. We've done a couple of videos before with Martin. We've done one about making elder beads.
That's right.
That was a very well received video. It was a great response from that. One of these ones. And one carving a burr cooksail, which was also another fantastically well received video. So, in this video, what we are looking to do is for Martin to teach you how to carve a spatula. As you do.
Yeah.
That's it. Because when you're in a survival situation, forget about food, forget about sustenance, forget about shelter. It's all about carving a spatula. But that's what's going to save you.
It is. And I mean, the other thing, if for example, you were, you know, stuck in a bathtub in the middle of Lake Superior, that's unlikely.
Yeah.
But if it were,
it's a possibility.
And you had a spatula with you, you could use it to row to shore.
That's it.
As it's happened to me quite a few times.
Yeah. And when you get onto shore, you can cook yourself a fried egg.
Yeah, that's right. It. Poke it about a bit.
That's it.
So a spatula is a really good, like...
It's like a survival item, isn't it?
It is. It is. You know, forget about knife, axe, you know, flint, all that stuff. Get yourself a spatula.
That's it. And so therefore, this video could potentially save your life. So, what we're going to do... We are joking, guys, obviously. What we're going to do is Martin is very kindly going to take some time out to teach you how to carve a spatula. Now, the couple of things I need to stress with this is firstly, we're going to do two different variations on how to you can carve a spatula. The first variation is you can use a shave horse. Okay, and Martin's going to talk through some of the techniques involved. Now, the first thing you're going to think for a percentage of you is you don't have a shave horse. Well, have no fear because we have that covered. And what Martin is going to do in section two of this video is teach you how to make a spatula using just an axe and a knife. There you go. So we've got everyone covered. And the other thing I need to stress here is we're doing this video in a way that really is a topic and a subject matter that you can go out and try yourself with very, very minimal equipment. And it's all about the skills employed. So, with your kind permission, Martin, the first thing we're going to do is actually shape a piece of wood. We're going to select a piece of wood, get the billet, and then move on from there. So, let's start the video on how you can carve a spatula. So Martin, the first step of the process is the type of wood that you want to use to carve a spatula.
Exactly, yeah. And because this is the sort of thing, you don't need to have a massive amount of skill or a massive amount of tools or like fantastically super wood to do it. What I've got here is some willow on the block here. I've got some alder here, and this thing looks like it's started growing already. Bit of alder as well there. And then a bit of hazel here. And what I'm going to do, we're going to split this willow and see if that is suitable for spatula. I think it should be because it's fairly even growth. And sometimes willow grows very quickly. And you'd see that from if the rings are like a long way apart. That might be a little bit soft, but we don't need anything too hard. But we don't, you know, we don't want anything sort of... Balsa's no good, you know, or
right.
Pine or anything like that. Something, a hardwood, a softer hardwood. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to split this. I've got an axe, obviously.
I was wondering what that was.
Yeah. I think this is the cutting edge here, this metal bit, rather than the other way around. This was made by my brother, John, working with Nick Westerman some years back.
Nice.
It's a bit of a beast, you know, it's quite heavy.
Are you talking about John or the axe?
Well, both, really. Nick Westerman's not that heavy, he's just normal-sized. His axes are probably the best in the world. Anyway, that's an ad. I'll be speaking to him about that later. And then I need something to hit the axe with, really. Because I could just swing it randomly.
Right.
But you can maybe see in this willow, there's a little tiny split there that's already appeared. And usually what one would do is look at splits that are already in the wood and focus on those. So I could, this is a flipping great hammer, I could hit this axe with a hammer, but that will start to dome the back of the axe over, mm-hmm. plus there are sparks, possibility of bits of metal flying off. So ideally I'd want to hit that with another piece of wood, and I'm going to put it across there like that, and I'm going to pick this beautifully shaped piece of wood up. Wait a minute, one of those, that one.
So one of the props from the flintstones.
Yeah. You can see this has been used for whacking all sorts of things over the years and months. And there's all sorts of names for this, a maul, a thumper, you know, lump of wood. And what I'm ideally going to do is, and this has probably only got another few weeks life left in it, because we do hit a lot of wood around here, a lot of axes rather. I'm going to try and clout that there and split the wood in half. Now as well, I'm standing here, and once I hit that, the axe is going to fly out sideways. Sometimes you think you put it that way, but of course if you hit that and the axe goes through there, phew, it just missed me kneecaps there. But ideally have it so that when you hit the axe and it comes out the wood, it's going to come out sideways.
Gotcha.
Sometimes you might want to do this with two of you, actually, somebody holding the axe and another person hitting it. But today we should hopefully get through this just the one of me.
Excellent.
Because there is only one of me. So I'm going to give that a fairly decisive clout on top, following that line of that split. And it won't split, will it? Right, well, I'm going to resort to the hammer. So, excuse the sound. I'm just going to give it a little tap with this hammer. That's got it started. Sometimes you do need a bit of weight.
Okay, so that's split quite nicely. Then,
yeah.
Isn't it?
So you can see we've got a nice... it's a nice colour as well. Now, not that that's your main thing, but nice colour, nice even grain. You can see a narrow pith there, little bit of knots in there. And then, so we've split that in half. And when you split timber, if you want it to split evenly, you want to split it half and half.
Right.
Because if you try to split that corner off, it would tend to pull away from the wood because it's an uneven... It's uneven amounts, if you like, if you know what I mean.
Right, gotcha.
So what I'm going to do is I'm going to quarter that piece. I'm going to set that to one side, that piece there, and I'm going to quarter that piece there. So same again. Put it on there so it's half and half. Give it a good old clout, and it falls off.
That's it. It's all part of the plan, though.
But it has actually split. So sometimes it's worth just giving it a tap to get it in. That split quite nicely. The other thing you could use if you've got one is a fro, which you probably know about, but I tend to use an axe for splitting, for this sort of splitting. Now, if you used a small piece of timber, you wouldn't have the option I'm going to talk about, but when you've got a larger piece like this, you've got the option of reassembling it. You could split a piece off there, what we call a tangential split, but as it dries it tends to curve a lot, tends to cup. So we've got a pieces in there that we can split out, that radiate out from the center like the spokes of a wheel, and we call that a radial split.
Gotcha.
So what we're going to produce is a radial billet, or, you know, out of a piece of wood like this for spoons or spatulas, you could produce probably a dozen radial billets. So I'm going to split it again, half and half. Lovely job. And then I'm going to split it again, half and half. Lovely job. And I'm going to use that piece there, I think.
So Martin, version 1.0.
Yes.
The Shtf horse.
This is one way of doing it. Shtf horse. This is a sort of German, Central European style Shtf horse, called a Z-Bank, or various names in German. And of course a draw knife, which is kind of the thing that goes with a Shtf horse. Now, not everybody's got a Shtf horse or a draw knife, but you can make your own Shtf horse. There are some good videos of people doing that on YouTube and here and there. And you can actually make your own draw knife. This is one I made with a chap called Nick Westerman, who I've never mentioned before, who's a genius. And yeah, it's good.
Fantastic.
And Shtf and draw knife, basically a Shtf is a sort of vice in a way, a device for holding a piece of wood that you can quickly let go. It's grip, you know, you press on the pedal and it grips it, press with your foot, grips it, move it around, you know, and it's a quick way of, it's a quick way of shaving down a piece of timber from one shape to another shape, you know, from the shape you don't want to the shape you do.
Gotcha.
So in this instance, what we're going to use it is just to flatten this timber out.
Okay.
And then in a minute we'll go and show you just how to do that with an axe.
Perfect.
So what I'm going to do, I mean, with a draw knife, you can just pull it towards you like that. Mm-hmm. That's fine. But often if you angle it like that, you get a longer cut and it cuts really nicely. You see those nice shavings coming off there. I'm going to flip it round, but it cuts the other way round. So it's cutting and splitting.
Gotcha. So what are you doing that? You're just flattening off the surface?
Yeah, I'm flattening the surfaces off, so it's nice and even. It's just a good way of doing that. So we've got a nice, basically producing a little plank.
Right.
You see it's getting quite, it's getting sort of, and I'll flip it over the other way up like that. Nice timber, nice piece of timber actually. It's cutting really nicely. Of course you can cut yourself with a draw knife quite easily, but One way to not cut yourself with a draw knife is to never pick it up or put it down, because as long as you've got both hands on it, you won't right. cut yourself.
Gotcha.
So, just to say, more sensible version, that is be careful when you pick it up and put it down.
Gotcha.
Especially on the corners then. I've ground the corners off there. But often they stay incredibly sharp.
Gotcha.
Yeah, so what we've got, I've got that down to reasonable thickness. Just going to take it a little bit thinner. A little bit thinner. Because a spatula can be, you know, wants to be fairly thin at the end. I like that. That'll do like that. We can do the rest of that with a knife and an axe.
Gotcha. So, Martin, we want to arrive at a billet which is kind of thinly shaped and even. So we've done a version with a shape hole. So now you're going to show us the version with an axe.
With an axe. I mean, you can see, it's just, we started with the same thin. Basically, it's thicker one side than the other. And really, fundamentally, we want to thin those sides down, make it as you know, nice and smooth on those sides. So what I'm going to do, I'm working on this fairly low block. I often work on a much higher block, but today I'm going to work on a low block. So you want to be in a good position when you work. If you're right-handed, you know, put your right leg back like that. So that, you know, just suppose this axe swings through, you know, it's not going to be in the way. And also that gives good support for your back. I could put my thumb over there to hold it, but just to be on the safe side, I'm going to tuck my thumb there. You know, I've never chopped my thumb off yet, and I don't want to start now. And what I'm going to do, I'm going to also be thinking about from the block up to halfway and maybe a fraction above. So I'm not going to start chopping there. So we're basically, we can do what are loosening cuts and planing cuts, but with a lot of this, we can just get away with the planing cuts, partly because it's a heavy axe. Planing that wood off to make it fairly smooth, and already that's quite smooth. So I've done that, really started there. I'm going to flip it up the other way. Now just be careful, because I'm saying that to me rather than anybody else. Just be careful, Martin, because that's not an even end. So also the way you hold an axe is important. I haven't got it kind of gripped really, really tight, because that gives you all sorts of problems in your hands and in your arm. The other thing is sometimes you see people put their thumb on the back of the axe when they work like that, and occasionally, as the bark falling off, occasionally that can be useful, but you don't want to do that too much because it transfers a lot of shock into your hand.
Gotcha.
So when you're using an axe like that, it wants to be, you know, you wouldn't say loose, but you certainly don't want to grip it like, you know, you're going to strangle it. So what we're doing, we're just working our way along there, trimming that down. Let's go the other way, as I say, and get away with just planing cuts, because I'm probably taking sort of 2 or 3 mil off at a time, and I want to make it, I've gone a bit high there, but anyway, I want to make it fairly even and fairly smooth. Fairly is a bit of a vague concept, but you know what I mean. And it's, that's losing a bit of wood, it's making it nice and even. And this is a good practice to do this, actually, for spoon carving, even if you've got a shave force and a draw knife. It's good to be able to do this. You know, I often use a shave force, draw knife for preparing billets, but, you know, if you haven't got one, and you're somewhere where you haven't got one, you're going to be a bit stuck. So you need to be able to do this, really, if you're carving spatulas and spoons. You need to be able to do it with an axe. Not quite as neat as my draw knife one, but that's not bad, you know. We can move on from there to working, to getting some shape on there. We might come back to the axe block, depending on how we draw it out, and then we'll go to the knife.
Perfect. So Martin, we are inside your abode.
Yes, yes.
And so we've got the two,
yes,
blank carved billets.
Two blanks billets there. And I'll just show you a couple of options for sort of spatula shapes. I mean, there are a bit like the spoons, you know, there are a number of possibilities. So my drawing skills are a bit wonky, to say the least. You can have curves or you can have angles. You can have symmetrical or you can have asymmetrical. So for example, you could have a spatula like that, that's a curve like that, with a straight handle like that. It's a bit thin. Oh dear. Don't make one like that. But you could, that's a possibility. The other possibility, or another possibility, is instead of having that edge, which is the poking edge, the flipping edge, you could have it at an angle like that. It's often more useful at an angle. And instead of having that a tight cutting, you can have it a flowing curve like that. That's an option. That works quite well. And you also want to think about giving yourself enough handle width to grab onto. You know, it wants to be a bit bigger than a toothpick or something like that. It depends. I mean, I've got enormous great hands, you know.
You know what I say about men with big hands, don't you? Big gloves.
Yeah, big gloves, exactly. Yes. So that's a possibility. Both of those are possibilities. So you think about curves and angles and stuff. And, you know, you might want to look at what you've already got, if you've already got spatulas, what works for you, what you like. And also, once you've made it, if you think, oh, dear, that's a bit steep, that angle, don't be frightened to come back and rework it.
Because I've sometimes seen, just over here, like, is it the keel, I think they call it?
Yeah.
Where they do it slightly rounded. Was it the other end? So when you're kind of wiping it around a pan,
yeah,
it kind of picks
that,
it up.
That's quite a good idea, is to actually have a very sharp sort of angle there and a more curved bit there. Because a lot of pans, you know, have a kind of a 90 degree base to side juncture, but some don't, you know, so that's quite useful. And you'll find over time that will wear off anyway. Another possibility, and the one that I'm going to suggest we do with this one, I'm going to swap over billets, is the other one. And we can, because this is asymmetrical, it's angled at the end already, we can use that angle a little bit. And what I'm going to do, I'm going to use my finger as a cutting edge here, and I'm going to put myself a line along there. Do you see what I'm doing?
Yep.
A bit like a marking gauge there. as being one side of the spatula. And then what I'm going to draw here is a fairly narrow one. I'm going to make it asymmetrical like that. I'm going to give that a curve there. And then I'm going to, again, I'm going to use my hand as a sort of gauge there like that. And actually I'll probably pull that in a bit there when we get to there. So we can do some of that work actually with an axe again. We can remove that strip there and we can remove some of this wood here. And, you know, we could put a saw cut in there to split that away. So what we'll do, I'll take this to the axe block. We've come inside, so we can do that sort of axing inside quite happily. It's a low block, so I'm going to stay in the chair to axe, and we'll take some of that material off.
Perfect. So Martin, we've got a wasps keeping us company now.
Yes, yeah, the wasps are waking up now. Because they're keen to see you, I think. I mean,
that's
who wouldn't be?
That's it, exactly.
Yeah. So what we've got, well, I've got a little block on the floor. I'm just going to take the outer strip off, and rather than swing at it with the axe, I'm just going to put the axe on there and drop it. You know, it's often what they call a drop cut, but it's mostly going to just split rather than cut. It didn't work. So I put it in again. All right, I'm going to have to resort to cutting it, but I'm cutting to the line there. Sometimes you can split stuff away really easily. So I've cut to that line more or less there. And then I'm going to do the same thing there. I'm going to, again, try and split that off. See if it'll... bit more successful there. Split that off there. Now, I could cut all that away, but I could also put a stop cut in there with a saw and try and split down to that. So I'm going to do a little bit of both. I'm going to cut some away first, then I'm going to put a saw cut in and chop to that. So I'm just going to put a saw cut in there. When I use a saw on these things, I tend not to cut right to the line.
Okay.
Because it's ever so easy to go over the line, and then you end up with a spatula or a spoon handle that is narrower than you want.
Mm-hmm.
Much better to leave it a little bit shy of the line and then carve that away.
Gotcha.
So I don't always use a saw, but it's, you know, it's quite a good way. So I'm gonna put a saw cut in there. What that means is I can get an axe in there and split down there. I don't want to bring an axe in too close for putting splits in there, and if that happens, we, you know, we want to chuck the thing. But let's put a little saw cut in there. This is a Japanese pull saw, Irwin Japanese pull saw, very sharp, ideal for sawing into your leg, and as you can see, sawing into your trousers.
That's it. But yeah, people pay a lot of money for jeans like that.
They do.
That's it.
Usually, if I'm organised, I have a piece of leather to sit on my knee if I'm doing that. But I've forgotten it, or I've eaten it, or something. So we're just going to have to be extra careful. You should always be careful anyway. But if you've got a bit of leather there, you know, and something goes wrong. So I'm just going to put that. I'm going to put that saw on there. It cuts on the pull, this saw. It's no good pushing it too hard. I could put this in a vise, but that's not very bushcraft vise, is it? Flip it around the other way so you can see what I'm doing. I'm almost happy with where that cut goes to. Okay, I'm going to split that. I'm going to try and split and cut that away. You notice I've got my leg out of the way there, just in case, you know. And that's split down there, and it hasn't continued. The split hasn't continued onto the spatula blade. Got to be a bit careful there with my fingers.
So at this stage, one thing I've learned is you've got to obviously be eyeing up where the grain is going, don't you?
Yes, you do.
So to make sure.
You do. And if for example, that grain was running down there, then that cut would be no use there as a stop cut. Because once you've got the axe in there, that split is going to run down there.
Yeah.
So this, you know, you can see from this this colour differential bit here that it's a fairly straight grained piece of wood. But yes, you do really have to bear in mind where the grain's going to go, because once you start relying on splits, then that split will go. You know, that split will go there whether you want it to or not. So we've got to be super, super careful down the bottom there. I'm actually going to cut that, and I'm almost pulling it back each cut. And now I'm just going to cut through that with the axe there, like that. I don't want to go too much further. I could do, but I would not want to risk that there. The other thing I could do with the axe is come in there. Again, I'm going to do a drop cut because I don't want to swing that too close above my finger.
Do you know with the drop cut, one question I have for you, and I've actually messed up a couple of times. When you do a drop cut, the axe sometimes jumps up.
Yes.
With the thing. What was it I was doing wrong there? Was I not...
Well, I'm not quite sure, but one thing I tend to do is, can you see there, actually, this is fairly sharp, this axe, actually almost used it to cut into the wood.
Right.
So it's in, you know, you could almost pick the wood up with it.
I understand.
So it's in the wood there, and then you pick them both up at the same time, and you can be fairly, you know, you can be fairly gentle in a way. I think I'm going to leave it at that for axe work there, because I don't want to risk taking that off.
Perfect.
But the other thing I want to do with the axe is thin the end right down.
Right.
So I'm going to put that on there, and really from sort of back here, I'm going to start shallowing it out with the axe until it's quite thin. I'm bringing the axe vertical and moving, angling the piece of wood. So can you see I've taken that quite thin there?
Gotcha.
It's not perfect. We can trim that up with a knife. But that'll do for the time being. Then I'm going to do some knife work in a minute.
So Martin, the knife work now.
Yeah. So, okay, we, you know, as I said earlier, we could do more there with an axe, but it's a bit risky there. So what we're going to do now is I'm going to use a knife just to, you know, try and work to these lines, and, you know, just get it into more the shape that I wanted. You could actually use it as it is, you know, if you wanted to poke a fried egg. So here we can take nice long shavings off there. I'm going to come to the side of me there. I'm going to put the piece of wood sort of against my leg. I'm using actually quite a small knife there. Usually I use a bigger knife, but I happen to bring a small knife out with me, made by a chap you've probably never heard of called Nick Westerman, that made this blade. He's a genius and should be knighted. So I'm just, you know, these long cuts sort of give you, you know, fairly long shavings. What you don't want to do when you're doing sort of knife work is hold the piece in the air and try and carve it. Because right. You use a lot of energy holding it up. Sit it against your leg, you know. Obviously you don't want to slice your leg open, but it's quite difficult to do that from here. I've cut the blue line off there. Flip it up the other way. Working fairly tight to that blue line. Just losing it. That's pretty good, I'm quite happy with that. Flip it around the other way, we can take that down there. And rather like with a draw knife, you know, you can go straight down, mm-hmm. or you can angle it, in which case you get longer pieces, a longer use right. of the blade like that. And it's like a slicing action. To cut that away, you need to go to another knife grip, because you can't really do that there. What I'd recommend for that, there's a couple of options. One is the what they call the supported grip. So I'm holding the object in the object, as we should now call it, in my left hand like that, and I'm holding my knife in the right hand fairly loosely, actually. Again, I'm not gripping it super, super tight. I'm putting the knife on the line there, and I'm sort of pushing it with my left hand. It's very difficult to cut yourself with this. I mean, you know, if I slipped, it wouldn't stab me in the chest. And the other thing with this is you can roll the knife as you go. You hear that lovely cutting, beautiful sound that a sharp blade makes. So that's a very controlled grip. And this is carving very nicely. And some quite nice grain in there as well. Just need to come a little bit tighter in there. Don't feel you've got a, you know, just because you've drawn a line on the wood, you haven't got to work to that line. But it's good to start with a line, I feel. Good to start with an idea of what you want to make, even if you subsequently change your mind. I'm going to go to a third grip to remove that material, a chicken wing or scissors or flying antelope grip, knife fairly, again, not gripped super tight, turned through 180 degrees so it's facing outwards, and you're going to work with your arms like this. If you take off at any stage when you're doing this, then you're doing it too vigorously. They're very short, very powerful.
Do you need to do a chicken sound as well when you're doing it?
Yeah. Meow, meow. Yeah. Go back to that supported grip just to clean that up a bit. So that is more or less a spatula. The other thing I would do, I just want to even that up there. Again, I'll do it. The other thing I would do with this, if this were mine, which in fact it is take the corners off. So turn that from a four-sided piece of wood into an eight-sided piece of wood. Shall I do that now for you?
Let's do that.
Yeah, let's do that. So I'm just going to run down there. You could just as easily do that with this. Makes it a lot more comfortable to hold, if nothing else. And then I'm just going to, just for visually, I'm just going to pull that in a little bit there. We've got plenty of thickness in there. Just want that to be, and I'm going to use a fourth grip, you know, the thumb push. A lot of people use that too much. It's very controlled grip, but it's tempting to use that a lot of the time. And if you use that all the time on carving a spoon or a spatula or whatever, you often end up with hand problems there. So you're better off spreading the load around your hand through varying the grips. The other thing there, that's a little bit chunky there, so I'm just going to thin that out a bit. The sort of semi chicken wing thumb push styly thing.
That's a technical name for it.
Yeah. One of the ways in which you're most likely to cut yourself, I'm not going to actually demonstrate, is catching your finger there, that finger there with the edge of the knife. And you can see there are little tiny nicks on there. And some people get around that by grinding the tip off your knife. I don't, but you need to be aware of where the end of your knife is. So I'm just thinning the end of the spatula blade out, just to make it easier to flip eggs over and things. Let's just clean that up a bit there. Thinning that blade out a little bit. You don't want it too chunky, but you don't want it so thin that it breaks. This is where a longer blade would be useful. Longer knife blade, that's to say, rather than spatula blade. Nice wood, I like it. The other thing I'm going to do is just come along there and clean that edge up, because that's just the sawn edge. I'm just going to work my way along there and Got a slightly cleaner edge on there, like that.
So you, essentially, you're thinking about ergonomics of using it, right?
Yes.
So you kind of have the reasons for the taper, the kind of cleaning of edges,
yes,
and holding
exactly,
and so forth.
It wants to be useful. And it's a very simple project, making a spatula, and it's probably a good starter project for somebody who wanted to carve spoons.
Right.
The other thing, it's quite, you know, it doesn't use a huge amount of wood. It doesn't matter too much if you go wrong. You're going to end up with something that's like a spatula. I mean, basically a stick would be a start over nothing,
yeah,
for poking a fried egg around. And you could take that away and use it and think, actually, that's a bit narrow. It could do with being wider. That angle's too steep. I want to narrow that off a bit. The handle is too thin there and too wide there. And you can use, the knowledge you gain from using something to go away and make something better. And I think it is very important that people who carve things, make things, actually use them and make them fit for use. It is, it's fantastic. You know, we could carve like Mediterranean scenes up here and Battle of Trafalgar there. But if you can't flip an egg with it, then it's not really that good. You know, and I think function should come before form. And you know, there are lots of ways of making this more beautiful, but what I'd do first is make it more useful, make it useful to you, make it the sort of thing that you would like to use.
Gotcha. So with this one then, would you say it's pretty much done now then?
Yeah, it's pretty much done. It's a bit ragged looking, it's a bit rough and ragged looking. So you might, what I might do with that, and what I very often do with spoons, and it's quite wet, the timber, I might leave it sat in a cool place for a day or something and come back to it and do some finishing cuts.
Right.
Yeah, there's plenty more I could do on this. I mean, what I will do actually before we finish is just clean that end off. I mean, what I often do with an end like that is just sort of chamfer it like that. Take an angle off each side, and that includes these little chamfers here. And then clean the final end up. See if we can take that off neatly. So we've just given ourselves a sort of fairly neatish end. Yeah, it's a bit rough and ready, this, but you know, for a sort of 5 minute job, really, you know,
yeah,
you've made yourself a useful spatula.
So there you go, guys. That is a wrap for this video. Martin, thank you so much.
It's been a pleasure, Jed.
Yeah. And so the point being is that we're keeping this video designed in a way where Martin's teaching you in a very short time. It took a bit longer because obviously we're explaining a lot of things, but intrinsically when you get down to it, what, 5 minutes?
Five minutes.
Yeah.
You could make half a dozen, you know, before you get up in the morning. That's not right, is it? But you know what I mean.
Yeah, that's right.
Before breakfast.
Yeah. You managed to do that before you wake up in the morning.
Yeah,
you know.
That'd be some feat, you know.
That would, isn't
it? In bed.
That's it.
No, don't do that, kids.
So,
don't, whatever you do, kids, don't carve in bed.
So the point is obviously to get a really refined spatula, whatever, take your time. Like Martin said, leave the dry for whatever, 1 or 2 days, and then go back to it and take your time with it as much as you want to embellish and so forth. The idea with this video was to actually teach you, and Martin has done a great job in doing so, in how to use a multiple variety of means to carve an item that is actually useful. And that's the main thing, with a few subtle kind of ergonomics to explain. So Martin, thank you once again.
It's a pleasure.
For doing that. Guys, if you haven't already checked out Martin, then why not? Guys, they haven't checked you out. This is not acceptable.
That person on the left there.
That's it.
I've never heard of him.
Yeah, that's it. You're watching the whole time. You haven't even done it. Yeah, we're watching you. We know who you are. So it would mean a lot to me. I'm going to put a link to Martin's social media below and his website. It literally below. It's over here somewhere. But anyway, it's there somewhere. Have a look, and it will mean the world to me if you go and check them out. If you go and follow them on Instagram, and if you go check out their website, you can see a list of all the other work that they do. Martin and his brother, and both Martin's wife, all three of them are very, very talented craftspeople doing some amazing work. So it would mean a lot to me if you go and check out the links below. Give them a follow on Instagram. Go and check out the website. Martin's a very approachable guy, even though he doesn't look it. He's a very approachable guy, and you can message him and so give him queries that you want. And most importantly, have a go.
Yeah, definitely.
I think it's a big thing.
Make yourself a spatula before breakfast every day for a month.
That's it, in your sleep.
Yeah.
That's it. That's it. It's not that difficult, trust me, when you try it. But the point is, go out there and try it, guys, honestly. And you know what? If you post up a picture on Instagram or Facebook, tag us, let us know.
We'd love to see what you do.
It'll be an absolute kick to kind of see you approaching it. We've done a couple of videos before with Paul Adamson, birch bark and so forth that people have been tagging, and it's been fantastic.
Yeah, great stuff.
And Martin, a while ago, done the video on beads.
Yeah.
You know?
There was bead mania, basically, it swept the Western world.
That was it. You know, the second Brit invasion since the Beatles in the 60s. That was it. Bead mania.
Mm.
That's what it was.
Yeah.
And so, have a go.
Spatulas can solve a lot of world problems.
That's it. In their sleep. That's it. A lot of things can be done in their sleep, Martin.
Yes, I hear.
That's it. We've learned that from this video too. So, there you go, guys. That's a wrap for this video. We appreciate you watching. Thank you once again.
Thank you, Zed. Always a pleasure to see you, my brother.
It really does mean a lot, Martin, to take out time and share stuff that he's been doing for many years and taking many years to hone in. Including the sleep. Sleep takes a lot of practice to hone in. And so, it would mean a lot to me. Go and check out the links below to Martin. And as always, from Martin and myself, I hope whatever you're doing, you have a blessed day, a blessed week ahead. This is Ed from Zedoutdoors and from Martin. Peace out.
Nice one.